The topic for today's lecture is the Indian economy. Now, there is a general impression about the Indian economy, which is as follows, that until recently, the Indian economy was doing wonderfully, that of late, new problems have arisen. And why these problems have arisen, what these problems are, how they can be resolved, are basically what are discussed. But I think this impression itself is wrong. When the Indian economy was supposed to have been doing very well, there was within this economy not only growing inequality, but in fact growing malnutrition. And since poverty in India is defined in terms of a nutritional norm, there was therefore growing poverty. Let me just give you some long-term historical data. If you look at the per capita food grain availability in what was called British India at the beginning of the 20th century, it was about 200 kilograms per year. So the per capita annual food grain availability in British India at the beginning of the 20th century was about 200 kilograms. It declined sharply after that, so that around the time of independence, it was actually in 1946-47, it was 138 kilograms. But then you can say that that's an exceptional year, but it declined sharply to less than 150 kilograms by the time of independence. After which, with great effort, there was an increase in the per capita food grain availability annual in the Indian Union. It rose to about 180 kilograms just on the eve of neoliberal reforms. That means by the end of the 1980s. Since then, it declined, rose a little, and at the moment, if you take the last 3 years, the average per capita food grain availability per year is actually less than what it was at the end of the 1980s. It's roughly about 170, 172 kilograms. Therefore, if you look at the most elementary index of people's well-being, then you find in terms of the most elementary index, the Indian economy was doing pretty abysmally, precisely in the years in which there has been an increase in the rate of growth of the GDP. Now, many people do not appreciate this point, and what they argue, they broadly put forward two kinds of argument. The first argument is that, look, obviously when you become better off, you diversify your consumption pattern away from food grains to all kinds of other things, both to other kinds of foods as well as to education, health, and such like things. And as a result, if people are actually consuming less food grains, then that is a symptom not of their becoming worse, but of their actually becoming better off, because as they are better off, they are actually diversifying away from food grains. Now, that this is a complete misnomer, because while it is certainly true that as people become better off, their direct ingestion of food grains diminishes. You don't actually go on eating more and more of food grains, you actually eat less. But their direct and indirect ingestion of food grains actually increases. Indirect being through animal feeds, animal products into which food grains enter as feed grains, and through processed foods. So if you look, for instance, at the United States, the per capita annual food grain availability in the US is about 800 kilograms, while in India, as I mentioned, it's about 170 kilograms at the moment. So the idea that somehow being rich entails a reduction in per capita total food grains output is a wrong idea. And if it is the case that you find that there is such a reduction, then that must be symptomatic of the fact that even though we have high GDP growth rates, large numbers of Indian people are really not seeing any increase whatsoever, perhaps a reduction in their per capita real income if it is appropriately deflated. By appropriately deflated, what I have in mind is that no consumer price index in India actually takes account of the effect of privatization of essential services. As you know, all price indices in India, consumer price indices, are really indices which are Laspierre price indices. They're basically base-weighted indices. How much would a certain basket cost in the base period? How much would the basket cost in the current period? But the fact that in that basket in the base period, you actually had public healthcare, public education, because privatization had not gone very far. And therefore, you simply look at how much public education costs today and public healthcare costs today, and that's your price relative. That is a gross underestimation of the actual inflation which occurs because people have increasingly been pushed out from the public system to the private system, which is far more expensive. Therefore, if you take an appropriate inflation index that takes care of the impact of privatization, then you would find that actually substantial segments of the Indian population have done badly, or perhaps at least in the nutritional sense, and therefore by inference perhaps also in terms of real incomes, worse off today than they were at the beginning of the period of liberalization. So this whole idea that 8% growth rate, what a wonderful thing the Indian economy is doing in this period since 1991 is a misnomer. There is no doubt at all that there's a substantial increase in the GDP growth rate, but vast numbers of the country's people have not only witnessed growing income inequality, but perhaps an absolute worsening, certainly an absolute worsening in their nutritional norms, and perhaps a worsening in terms of their real income if we appropriately deflate it. But then, everybody, however, is agreed that today, what the Indian economy is doing is actually something which should cause concern. A number of symptoms are clear. These symptoms are there is a balance of payments problem. Meeting the current account deficit of the balance of payments is problematical. The exchange rate of the rupee has depreciated very sharply. You have a slowing down of the growth rate. You have an acceleration that is occurring in the rate of inflation. So on all this, and of course, employment growth has actually come to an end. If anything, there is even, some people argue, an absolute reduction in employment, and certainly in the last few years there has been virtually no growth as far as employment is concerned. So if you look at all these obvious indices, then the Indian economy is performing very badly at this particular moment. And this is something on which there is a general agreement, though of course for political reasons people may tend to put it in different ways, but the fact is that the economy has been doing very badly. The fact that the economy was doing well earlier, and that was accompanied by a worsening in the nutritional standards, at least of the population, does not mean that when the economy is doing badly, there would actually be an improvement in the nutritional standards of the population. In other words, what this would mean is that when the economy is doing badly as now, the nutritional standards of the population would actually go down further, because you'd find that unemployment would be even more acute, purchasing power in the hands the people would be even less, and so on. I should just add that during the period that the nutritional norms of the people were going down, India has been exporting substantial amount of food grains to the world market. And this is something which is quite remarkable, because people here are actually getting less and less calories. But on the other hand, India is exporting food grains. The obvious inference to draw is that the problem lies not on the supply side, but on the demand side, in the sense that there is inadequate purchasing power in the hands of the people to actually buy even the amount of per capita food grains that used to do earlier. In the morning, I gave some figures. I'd like to repeat them, that if you take, and poverty in India is defined with respect to a nutritional norm, namely anybody in urban India with less than 2100 calories per person per day is defined as poor. Anybody in rural India with less than 2200 calories per person per day is defined as poor. If you simply take the proportion of the population that falls below these nutritional norms, this proportion has gone up. In 1993-94, the proportion of the population falling below this norm was in rural India 58%. It has gone up to 68% in 2011-12. And in urban India, the corresponding figures are 57% and 65%. Now, the fact that people are getting nutritionally deprived is not because of a voluntary choice on their part to move away to something else, which is against, as I mentioned, at least observed human nature, but it is because of a shortage of purchasing power in their hands, which is a result of the fact that there is an enormous squeeze on the petty production sector, including agricultural laborers, peasant agriculturists, fishermen, craftsmen, and so on, combined with the fact that there is not enough employment generation within the growing capitalist sector. I'll give you a bit of statistic which may be of some interest to you. It was mentioned by Professor Lakshmi that I was in the Kerala State Planning Board. When I was in the planning board, we did a little study. We said that suppose every fisherman in Kerala actually got the statutory minimum wage of the state, how would this sector look? And it turns out that if every fisherman got the statutory minimum wage, which is the wage given under the MGNREGS, then the entire fisheries sector in Kerala would be in deficit. That basically means the entire fisheries sector in Kerala was running because the fishermen on average were getting a daily return that was less than the statutory minimum wage of the state, and therefore that was less than what they could have got by working on an MGNREGS project. Of course, but people don't, nobody wants to give up your own occupation to go and work in an MGNREGS project, which is why they did not. But that is the state of affairs as far as the petty production sector is concerned. So the point is that in this period, therefore, if there is a worsening of the economy's performance, then the growth of purchasing power in the hands of the people would become even less, and therefore you would have a worsening of the nutritional and other kinds of standards. So the fact that the economy was doing well but the people were doing badly does not mean that when the economy is doing badly, the people would do well. In fact, on the contrary, they would do even worse. All right. The question is, why is the economy doing so badly? And here I would like to relate what's happening in the Indian economy to what is happening in the world economy. I think a lot of what we see is happening in the Indian economy is related to developments in the world economy, though this is an aspect which is often ignored in the standard discussions. Basically, in my view, the entire neoliberal phase of capitalism has now reached a dead end. The entire neoliberal phase of capitalism has actually reached a cul-de-sac. This is not something I'm just asserting. It is very clear from the fact that in the biggest capitalist country of the world, which is the United States, President Trump is introducing protectionist measures. Now, if neoliberalism means anything, it means free flow of goods and services and capital and finance across countries. Now, here is the biggest, most powerful capitalist countries that is actually preventing the free flow of goods and services and introducing protectionism, which therefore itself ipso facto suggests that the entire neoliberal phase of capitalism has really reached some kind of a cul-de-sac, which is why the president of the US is actually forced to take these measures. Now, it's not as if he's doing these measures because of some crazy ideas of his own. alone. He's doing these measures because in the United States, there is an acute problem as far as the working class is concerned, which is why he got elected, because he at least noted that problem. Hillary Clinton did not even mention the crisis, while Trump was at least talking about crisis and unemployment. Therefore, no matter what one may think of his political other views, why is there a crisis and why has Trump introduced protectionist measures? What are the implications of this for economies like ours? Well, the crisis is very clear, because if you look at the period after the Second World War, capitalism had what is called the golden age of capitalism, because that was a period in which there was state intervention in demand management, much the way that John Maynard Keynes had advocated. Keynes had said that you know, Keynes, as you know, was very strongly anti-socialist, and therefore he was afraid that if you had unemployment of the kind that interwar years had seen in the capitalist world, in that case you would find that the socialists would take over. So he wanted capitalism to actually get rid of that unemployment in order to be able to survive. And for that, he advocated state intervention in demand management. And of course, his book, The General Theory, was really the theoretical justification for state intervention in demand management. Now, therefore, you had actually a period in which there was state intervention in demand management, and capitalism actually had very low levels of unemployment. When I went to England to study, in fact, the level of unemployment in the UK was less than 2%. And one of my professors in Oxford, Professor Thomas Balog, I don't know if you know of him, in my time he was a big development economist, that, you know, if in Britain unemployment reaches 2.5-3%, then there'll be fascification of this country, because unemployment is conducive to the growth of fascism. He had been a Hungarian Jew who had emigrated from Hungary to Britain during the Nazi period. So the thing is that, you know, that unemployment levels were really brought down. And that's why you call it the golden age of capitalism, because with low unemployment, workers' bargaining strength was high, and therefore when labor productivity increased, with low unemployment and high levels of demand, there was a lot of investment taking place, therefore a lot of high rate of growth, and when with high rate of growth of labor productivity, and workers' bargaining strength was high because of low unemployment, so wage rates increased as labor productivity increased. Therefore, the working class did very well. Generally, there was an improvement in living standards, which is why that entire period is called the golden age of capitalism. But after that, with globalization of capital, now I just want to go a little bit back into this. If you have a world of nation states, which is what introduced demand management, then if you have governments which are based on the basis of elections within a nation, if you have nation states, then within a nation state, you cannot really have intervention by the state in demand management of the sort that Keynes was talking about without there being opposition from finance. Finance doesn't like state intervention, but on the other hand, if finance is globalized and the state is a nation state intervening, finance would go out of the country, creating a crisis, and therefore state intervention in demand management requires control on financial flows. This is what had happened under the Bretton Woods system. As a matter of fact, Keynes had written an article in 1933 in a journal called Yale Review, in which he had said, finance above all must be national. That you cannot have international finance. You cannot have free financial flows if the state is going to retain an autonomy for demand management, for generating high levels of employment, which he thought was essential for the future of capitalism. But in fact, what happened in the 1960s is that increasingly there was globalization of finance. The background to why this globalization happened and so on, we can discuss later on in the question answer session. But there was, starting from the 1960s, there was a process of globalization. Finance started going across countries. Originally in Europe, subsequently in Africa and Latin America, and in India, the economy was opened up to globalization of finance in the 1990s. In Africa and Latin America in the 80s, in Europe in the 70s, late 60s, 70s basically. With that, now, there is no instrument available with which to deliberately increase the level of activity. The state can't intervene, because if the state intervenes either through a fiscal deficit or by taxing rich people to spend more, in that case, you actually have finance disliking it and leaving the country. The state intervening by taxing poor people to increase its expenditure is not good enough. Why not? Because if the state takes 1 rupee of tax from a poor person, since the poor person generally spends the entire income, then it reduces expenditure by 1 rupee. And when the state spends that 1 rupee, then demand rises by 1 rupee. So you have no net increase in demand. In other words, you have a balanced budget multiplier of zero. Those of you who are students of economics. But on the other hand, if the state taxes the rich, but part of the tax has fallen savings, which is why the state taxing the rich and spending is something which can generate net demand. That would not be liked by finance. Fiscal deficit is not liked by finance. Therefore, the state as an instrument of intervention in demand is something which is out under neoliberalism, which is why most countries actually have fiscal responsibility legislation. You actually have limits upon fiscal deficit. So the thing is that now the main instrument which had been used by capitalism in the post-war period for increasing the level of activity is an instrument that's not available. Even if though it's not available, capitalism actually did quite well, because even though there was no state intervention in the post-1970s or 80s period, nonetheless, particularly the post-70s period, nonetheless, you actually had the stimulation of asset price bubbles. Asset price bubbles, when your asset prices rise, this brings about a wealth effect as far as people are concerned on their expenditures. And consequently, demand increases, growth takes place. In the 1990s, in the US, which is of course the most important country whose bubbles actually matter the most, in the US you had the dot-com bubble in the 1990s. Earlier this century, you had the housing bubble, because of which world economy grew relatively rapidly. And as a result, that growth collapsed, however, in 2008, and after that there has been no bubble, and which is why the entire world capitalist economy has entered a phase of stagnation, in which unemployment has been acute, in which the distress of the workers is acute, which explains partly why all this Brexit takes place, which explains also why a person like Trump gets elected. Which explains the general upsurge of fascism all over the world, because unemployment, as I mentioned earlier, is conducive to the growth of fascism. Particularly in Europe, we have very strong fascist parties coming up everywhere, including in France and Poland and everywhere, even in Britain. So the thing is that, you know, that this is now the state of affairs as far as the capitalist world is concerned. This state of affairs is something which affects us. Looking at it differently, what I call neoliberal capitalism having reached a cul-de-sac is something which we are observing here. Even our earlier growth, that 7%, 8% growth rate, was really a fallout of a period of boom in world capitalism. The period of boom in world capitalism helped us in at least three ways. One way is that directly a whole lot of, if the world economy is growing, demand in the world economy is growing, a whole lot of exports we make, naturally the demand for these exports would also increase. Secondly, when the world economy is growing, in the period of globalization, in the period in which there was this kind of growth, a lot of outsourcing took place. You know, capital tended to, metropolitan capital, American capital, for instance, tended to locate plants in China for producing manufactured goods based on cheaper Chinese labor to meet the American and European markets. Similarly, there's a lot of outsourcing of activities from the United States in the service sector, particularly IT-related services, to countries like India. All these call centers that came up. So the first if you like, our exports increased because of outsourcing. Our exports, traditional exports, also increased because of the boom conditions in the world economy. And thirdly, what actually happened, this is quite important, is that, you know, that a lot of finance tended to move out, because this was a period in which, as I mentioned, there was globalization of finance. Finance was going everywhere. It came here as well. And when finance came here, it tended to invest in stock markets, for instance. When it invested in the stock market, you had stock market booms. So it generated bubbles in particular countries to which it flowed in. And these bubbles in turn generated demand here. The tremendous increase in the domestic market for a whole range of luxury goods, which arose because those who are beneficiaries of these asset price bubbles here, generally the richer people who have assets, because the poor don't even have assets, were the people whose demand went up for a whole variety of goods. As a result, you had the high rate of growth in the Indian economy itself being, if you like, a fallout of the boom conditions in the world economy. Now that actually you have the opposite taking place, all the things you find in the Indian economy, all the problems that you find in the Indian economy, are problems which are the other side of this collapse of the world boom. Let's begin. I mean, suppose the most obvious problem which you find in India today is, of course, the collapse of the rupee, or the progressive collapse of the rupee. The exchange rate of the rupee has fallen quite dramatically. Ask yourself why the exchange rate of the rupee has fallen quite dramatically. India always, unlike China, had a current account deficit on its balance of payments. In other words, China always had a current account surplus on its balance of payments. India always had a current account deficit in the balance of payments. This did not matter as much because this was easily financed, because finance capital was flowing into the economy. As a matter of fact, the problem was that more finance was flowing into the Indian economy than our current account balance of payments required. Therefore, if nothing had been done by way of intervention, the rupee would have appreciated. But to prevent the appreciation of the rupee, which would have made Indian exports uncompetitive in the world market, the Reserve Bank of India intervened and held on to enormous amounts of foreign exchange reserves. These foreign exchange reserves that were held, in lieu of them, rupees were made available to the foreigners. Then they spent it. They invested in all kinds of assets. They invested it in the stock market, because of which you actually had a stock market boom bubble, and because of that you actually had some boom conditions being generated. What's happening now is actually that not only is it the case that finance is not flowing in adequate quantities to meet our current account deficit, but as a matter of fact, finance is beginning to flow out. India is not the only country. As a matter of fact, from all over the world, this is a remarkable feature of capitalism, namely that whenever there is any panic, whenever there is any collapse in the kind of, you know, buoyancy of the spirit of the speculators and capitalists, then they tend to rush to their home base. And the United States is the home base. It is amusing that in 2008, when you actually had the collapse of the housing bubble and the entire US financial system was in a mess, you actually had a tremendous inflow of funds from all over the world to the US. Why? You would have thought that this is a country facing a crisis. Money should be flowing out of the US, but no. In fact, money was flowing into the US. Why? Because of the fact that it is the home base of capitalism. Periods in which there is a loss of confidence as far as the capitalists, speculators, entrepreneurs, etc. are concerned, are periods when they actually rush back to the home base and rush back to the currency of the home base. As a result, at this moment, because I said that neoliberal capitalism has reached a cul-de-sac, which is visible in terms of Trump's protectionist policies, there is a general uncertainty about what's going to happen in the world economy. You actually find from everywhere finances flowing into the US, which basically means that a whole range of currencies are actually depreciating vis-a-vis the dollar, rupee above all, but rupee is not the only one. So we are witnessing, obviously, even on the foreign exchange front, the fallout of the kind of crisis that is now prevalent in neoliberal capitalism. When you have this crisis, what do? Textbook economics might suggest that, let the rupee fall, there'd be some equilibrium level at which it'll stabilize. That's just complete nonsense because, firstly, it takes a very long time, if at all, the world economy's demand for our goods happens to be sufficiently elastic and so on, it takes a very long time before our exports to increase, before our imports to decline and so on. So the standard mechanism of balance of payments adjustment is a mechanism that simply takes too long to work, if at all. And of course, if your currency is depreciating and so is everybody else's currency, then you don't even have that mechanism working. As a result, the standard mechanism where you say, we'll reach equilibrium exchange rate at some point, is something that's not going to work. And what is more, when there is a decline in the exchange rate of any currency, it gives rise to expectations that there may be a further decline. If it gives rise to those expectations, then people start all the more moving out of the rupee towards the dollar, and that in turn actually gives rise to a further decline. So you can have enormous falls in the value of a currency almost overnight if you just waited for equilibrium ever to take place. Therefore, the idea that we should do nothing and wait for equilibrium to arise is an idea that's a bogus idea. Typically, in a situation like this, what happens is therefore to raise the interest rate. If you raise the interest rate, then you may find that, people may get attracted to bring their currency, their funds back into your economy. But we should be clear here about one thing. During all these years, when after 2008, as you know, when there was a crisis in the world economy, the US, in order to stimulate its own economy and thereby the world economy, brought down its interest rates virtually to zero, while we had high interest rates. Part of the reason that we had never any problems about finance flowing into the Indian economy is because our interest rates were always much higher. And in fact, after 2008, there was a very clear gap between the Indian interest rates and the interest rates in the US, both short and long-term interest rates, which were both very close to zero. Now the US has started raising its interest rates. And when it raises interest rates, that's an additional reason, apart from the general uncertainty prompting capital to fly to its home base, the additional reason that there is a rise in the interest rate and promises of further increases, because of which capital is flowing. So it's not enough for us to raise the interest rate, but we have to keep raising it as the US starts raising it. But the problem with raising interest rates is that, of course, it affects the domestic level of activity. Problem of raising the interest rates is that it increases the cost of credit, and as it increases the cost of credit, in particular, small producers, petty producers, etc., further get squeezed because credit becomes expensive as far as they are concerned. Now, because of this particular reason, you find that there is a conflict between wanting to expand the level of activity at a time when it is shrinking because of the world crisis and the objective of maintaining a balance of payments equilibrium because of the same crisis in the world economy. In other words, the crisis in the world economy is something which, on the one hand, is making the value of the rupee unsustainable, our exchange rate unsustainable, and if you wish to, and also the level of activity is something which is going down. So if you wish to improve the balance of payments or make it sustainable by raising the interest rate, that's going to affect the level of activity, worsen unemployment even further. I mentioned that unemployment has, if anything, been getting in absolute terms aggravated in the recent period. It'll get further aggravated. Now, this in turn is something which brings me to an interesting analytical point. I assume most students here are economic students, so let me just go into it a bit. You see, there is a theorem put forward by Jan Tinbergen, who was the first recipient of the Nobel Prize in Economics. That's a pretty obvious theorem. He says that if you have, suppose it's the government, if you have N objectives, the government has N objectives, it must have at least N instruments for meeting these objectives. More than N is fine, because then you can choose between instruments or convex combinations of instruments. If you have N objectives and you have less than N instruments, it becomes impossible for you to meet all the objectives. Now, you see, neoliberalism puts us in a situation like that. As I mentioned earlier, fiscal policy is something which now is more or less out as a means of intervention in demand management and therefore as a means of influencing level of activity. Exchange rate policy, in any case, for reasons I was just saying, it really doesn't work. You know, it takes too long to work, and in between you can have enormous kind of exchange crisis. And therefore, the only instrument which we have is the interest rate policy. The interest rate policy is supposed to both stimulate activity, raise the GDP growth rate, increase activity, reduce unemployment, and so on. So it's supposed to increase activity. It's supposed to maintain your balance of payments by attracting capital. And it's also supposed to control inflation. Now, you can't have three objectives being satisfied by one instrument. And as a matter of fact, some of the conflict you find between the Reserve Bank and the government of India is really a conflict that reflects, if you like, or is a reflection of this fundamental contradiction in a neoliberal regime, that you actually have only one instrument for meeting multiple objectives. So the government of India, because election year is coming, would actually like to lower the interest rate somewhat and pay, you know, I mean, give out some loans so that there's a bit of activity taking place, bit of kind of support as far as the economy is concerned. So it would like a somewhat lowering of the interest rate. But the Reserve Bank of India can't afford to do it, because if it did so, then of course finance would not come and the balance of payments would be in a crisis. And as the exchange rate depreciates, cost of imported goods goes up, and because of which again you find inflation goes up. So inflation control, balance of payments control would require a rise in the interest rate, while expanding activity and reducing unemployment would require a lowering of the interest rate. I'm not talking about whether it will be effective in lowering, whether a lower interest rate would be effective in enlarging activity and reducing unemployment. I'm not going into that. But at least the direction of movement is something which is contradictory. Any government which wants to expand activity would lower the interest rate, but any government that wants to attract finance would tend to raise the interest rate, and there is an obvious contradiction between this. And I think that's a contradiction embedded within a neoliberal regime. Obviously, there is no solution to this contradiction within the neoliberal regime. If the world economy suddenly revived, then of course many of our problems would disappear. But the world economy is not going to revive. The idea of Trump going protectionist would imply that America may do well until such time that others have not retaliated. Because protectionism is what economists call a beggar my neighbor policy. Basically, it means that you export unemployment. That instead of buying Chinese goods, we produce our own goods, which means our unemployment reduces, China's unemployment increases. So protectionism is a beggar my neighbor policy. If the Chinese retaliate, and if other countries retaliate, in that case, even the benefits of a beggar my neighbor policy would be transitory, and as a matter of fact, they would no longer, US would no longer benefit from it. While US may not benefit from it, the fact that all countries are at each other's throats would actually further lower the incentive to invest and actually further worsen the world capitalist crisis. Therefore, this entire route that Trump is taking or the advanced capitalist world is taking, which is either doing nothing or going protectionist, is something which is not going to get rid of the crisis. You have to wait until some new bubble has been generated, but nobody knows when that is going to happen or whether that is going to happen. And if it happens, it may be again transitory before it collapses. Once more, there'll be a crisis. The other alternative, which is really the Keynesian alternative, is that, okay, national level demand management, nation state demand management is something which is out now because finance is globalized. What about having a global state that can do global demand management? Now, obviously, you do not want to have a global state, but a surrogate global state. By the way, Keynes had suggested it during the Depression of the 1930s. By a surrogate global state, what he meant is that a coordinated fiscal stimulus by several advanced countries together. Now, suppose the US, China, Germany, Japan, they all got together and said, all right, let's expand our fiscal, our expenditures, budgetary expenditures by 10% and finance it through a fiscal deficit. In that case, you have an agreed, different states then act together to constitute a surrogate global state, and the surrogate global state then carries out an expansionary fiscal policy. This was an idea suggested in the 1930s by a group of German trade unions, and also it was suggested by Keynes. Now, that is a possibility, but such a coordinated fiscal stimulus nobody is talking about, nobody has even mentioned it. And what is more, as I said, Trump has actually gone protectionist, in other words, isolationist, as opposed to a coordinated policy. Therefore, the world economy, as I said, is now going to be stuck in this situation for a long time. Neoliberal capitalism has reached a cul-de-sac, and the kind of problems which we are seeing in the Indian economy, consisting of A, a collapsing rupee, B, a reduction in the level of activity and increase in unemployment, C, an acceleration that is occurring, has started occurring in the rate of inflation. In fact, they would worsen because, as I mentioned, speculation would then start operating against the economy. When the rupee starts collapsing, people are going to now expect it to collapse, which would make it collapse further, and so on. The only alternative that I believe is really available to us, assuming, which I think is reasonable, that the world economy is not going to revive because there's no coordinated fiscal stimulus, no surrogate global state, is therefore to delink from this process of globalization. By dealing here, I mean dealing to the extent necessary by putting controls on immediately. Of course, we have to have some import controls in order to make our balance of payments viable. It's not going to be easy, but there I see no alternative to it. In 2013, when there was a similar run on the rupee, the government of India at that time had introduced import controls on gold. A lot of people, thinking that the rupee is collapsing, had moved to gold, and therefore gold imports had gone up, and therefore the government of India put controls on gold imports. Because it put controls on gold imports, that itself tended to curtail the trade deficit, and therefore things then expectations took over and things stabilized themselves. I think some degree of import control is absolutely essential. If Trump can do import control, I don't see why we cannot, because the Americans cannot in all seriousness turn around and say that we have a right to put controls on our imports, but you have no right. So I think that is something which is essential. But the moment you do import controls, then finance, which is already beginning to flow out of the country, may get frightened. They may think that, India is going to become a hostile place now, and therefore more finance may start moving out, for which then you'd have to have capital controls. Keynes had suggested capital controls in his Yale Review paper. Capital controls were there as a part of the Bretton Woods system. In fact, in India, there was such strict capital control that when I went abroad to study, there was a system called P-Form, and I was allowed to take with me only £3, which was not even enough for me to get to my university town from the airport, because by the time I paid the bus fare and stayed one night in a bed and breakfast place, I had run out of money completely. That was the tightness of the exchange control, and therefore, of course, a capital control. So we may have to have, we will have to have capital controls, controls particularly on financial outflows, and this can be done in a number of ways. You know, many countries, Mahathir of Malaysia had introduced capital control during the East Asian crisis. Really speaking, we are now going to be facing a period in which world oil prices are not going to be as low as they have been in the past. The reason why oil prices in the world had been low in the past is because of the fact that there was disunity within OPEC. While other countries wanted higher oil prices, Saudi Arabia did not. And as a result of this disunity, world oil prices had actually collapsed. Now there is an agreement within OPEC. Even Saudi Arabia now says that $100 a barrel is a reasonable price, which means there is going to be an escalation by at least 25% in the world oil prices. And consequently, if we are going to not have the impact of cost push inflation arising from that source in the economy, then we have to do something about it. The argument that, look, I mean, okay, oil prices rise, but let's reduce our taxes to keep the oil price charged to the customers unchanged is an argument which may sound okay to start with, but it does mean a loss of revenue. And then therefore it must mean a loss of some expenditure. And this expenditure typically might well be in welfare expenditure, social expenditures and so on, which is very bad. And as a result, I would much rather actually have direct price controls in a lot of commodities which could be the victims of this cost push inflation. You could even have price controls. You can have lower taxes, of course, but together with the lower taxes, take some other measures to raise the revenue. And the measure which I had suggested in the morning, I reiterate, is of course a wealth tax. It's amazing that India doesn't have a wealth tax. We could, instead of raising money on petrol products, raise tax revenue through a wealth tax. And that would mean some kind of a control on prices. But of course, if you have such control on prices, then there may be, I mean, you know, you cannot have such control on prices and let demand be free. Because in that case, obviously, you may have increases in demand taking place, which would then affect your balance of payments. Therefore, I think control on prices has to be accompanied by some degree of control over the distribution. Now, Delhi, for instance, had an odd-even scheme. Odd-even scheme, which was introduced, you know, that on some days only cars with even numbers can be on the roads, and other days cars with odd numbers. Now that was done for, you know, environmental reasons. But on the other hand, that's also a means of petrol product rationing, because that is actually something that brought down the overall demand for petrol products, because only half the cars of Delhi could be on the roads on a particular day. So in many countries of the world, for instance, you have, for instance, a rule that within certain hours, no car can ply on the road that does not have a certain minimum number of passengers in it. I mean, that's true of Thailand and Singapore and many other places. In India, that's not the case. I mean, everybody is driving merrily, one person per car. So I think one can introduce in various ways petrol product rationing. So I'm suggesting import controls, capital goods controls, price control through a reduction in taxes on petrol products, but the revenue to be made up through a wealth taxation, control on the distribution of petrol products. But all these are, of course, ways of coming to terms with the existing balance of payments crisis and also the inflation that is generated thereby. But that's not enough, because after all, we need to overcome unemployment. We need to generate growth in the economy. Now, if the world capitalist system is now going to be sunk in a fairly protracted period of crisis, then the only way that this growth can be generated in our economy is through an expansion of the domestic market. Expansion of the domestic market here would mean, of course, number one, a more egalitarian distribution of income. And number two, the home market here has to be essentially an agriculture-led growth, because that is our domestic sector, where expansion would give rise to an overall increase in the size of the market. Agriculture-led growth would also imply, require that the government re-support, re-protect, re-promote the petty production sector, not to remain forever as a petty production sector, but maybe to improve its base for technological upgradation, for reaping economies of scale, etc., through voluntary cooperatives, through voluntary collectives, and so on. As I said, destruction of the petty production sector is disastrous in economies like ours, because it simply throws people out of the sector who cannot be absorbed elsewhere, therefore poverty increases. We cannot therefore throw them out, but think in terms of improving the sector in other ways, improving the technological base in the sector in other ways, that would necessarily have to be through voluntary cooperatives and collectives and such like. Therefore, I think we have to rethink our entire economic strategy. Greater emphasis on egalitarianism, greater emphasis on welfare expenditures and social expenditures, enlarging the social wage for everybody, greater emphasis on agriculture and petty production, having controls on capital flows, trade and prices, and therefore some degree of delinking from the process of globalization. In fact, in the morning I was suggesting that in order to institutionalize all this, in order to ensure that actually such a thing happens and has the support of the people, it would be a good idea if, in keeping with a democratic tradition, we actually institutionalize a set of economic rights which are constitutionally guaranteed for every Indian citizen. And these, as I mentioned in the morning, could be right to employment, right to food, right to quality publicly funded universal healthcare, right to quality publicly funded universal education, and of course old age and disability benefits. And these should be justiciable, universal, constitutionally guaranteed rights, in which case once more you can have a revival of public enthusiasm, a revival of a spirit where you can say that I'm proud to belong to this nation as its citizens. Thank you.